computer wants to start recording. There we go.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to yet another Rookie Team League. This is going to be week number 6. I am, of course, your host, Shamtu. You can see that I've introduced a new little element into my casting UI here. You can see that there's this nice little bottom right-hand corner is now kind of fully developed. I just did this moments before starting this. But I digress. Let us get into these matches. Ladies and gentlemen, spawning up here at the 9 o'clock position of Katrina SE 2.0. From Team Urk, it is Agony, the Teal Protoss. And spawning down here at the 6 o'clock position is going to be our blue Terran player from Team Asesia. It is going to be Mafia. I wanted to start a little bit earlier today, but I didn't actually have the chance to do so. I was actually going to start at 3, so starting at 2 p.m. is a little bit earlier than I intended. A very early scout coming out here from Mafia. That was like a 7 scout. That was very early. So a little bit curious. I'm expecting we're going to probably see something like a BBS at this point, given that this is way earlier than expected. But let me just do a little bit more of my intros. Of course, if you're watching this, please do me the favor and follow and subscribe. And these go live every Sunday until RTL is over with. At this point, I'm also going to say that this is also going to be streamed live on Twitch. So if you hear me interacting with the chat, that is completely why. But if you miss any of these series, or you're too tired because you're in Europe or something, or you're going to go watch the Super Bowl, be sure to catch these on my YouTube, youtube.com/shamtu. Ooh, the Gastiel against a Protoss. Now that is not something we typically see. Meanwhile, back here, Mafia is going to throw down the Supply Depot. No barracks just yet, but it's going to force their opponent into a mostly zealot-based army until anything can happen. So that's a nice way to stop any type of early aggression coming out there from a Protoss, or force them into a 2-gate. The probe's going to scout over in the wrong position. It's going to scout at the 3 o'clock position and not be able to know what Mafia is up to. Of course, at this point, seeing that the refinery went down, you know that your opponent has already spent 100 minerals doing something. So it's a little bit odd to go and say, oh, what are they going to possibly be doing? Because all their tech is going to be delayed as well. So refinery and barracks coming down now. It looks like Agony is actually going to take this opportunity to instead go for a very quick Nexus. Now, the natural Nexus on Katrina is very well protected. You don't really have to worry about too much except for drops later on. So at this point, going for such a strategy is probably pretty smart. It does get immediately scattered out here by Mafia. So now if Mafia goes for heavy aggression, Mafia's throwing down a bunker. So I think Mafia is gonna probably do some sort of FD. Cancels the bunker though. A very interesting set of circumstances is happening in the beginning of this map so far. It's a lot of kind of meta outplaying the other. Throws down the block on the refinery. The assimilator now is going to finish up there, by the way. Throws down the block on the refinery, then decides to go into an FD with a bunker to go for, I would only assume, which is a very quick natural command center. Forces their opponent into a quick Nexus and Zealot-focused army in the beginning. So far we have a very interesting set of, never mind. This is not, in fact, going to be a very quick command center. This is going to be a double factory play, which is going to be hyper effective against Agony, who went for this very early Nexus. Now, the caveat here is that if Agony is able to get a couple of macro cycles out of this Nexus before Mafia is able to move across the map, then Mafia is going to be in a world of trouble. However, it doesn't look like Mafia is going to be able to do that. I don't think Mafia is going to have a problem, I should say, in getting this a push across the map before Agony is going to be prepared for this. So Agony right now is in a world of trouble. The only good thing going right now for Agony is that we'll have the high ground advantage protecting the natural and the main. So if enough Dragoons can come out in time, Agony may be able to hold this off, but with only one gate so far, a second gateway has just barely begun. Agony right now needs to know that this is happening before it actually hits, and there's already a number of Marines and a Vulture out to go against two Zealots and a Dragoon. This push out might give Agony the information that they need in order to throw down a lot more gateways and, oh, okay, never mind, a lot more gateways coming in anyway. If Agony can delay Mafia long enough, this might go in Agony's favor. But Mafia is already moving across the map. We've got six Marines, a Vulture, and a tank with more on the way. Another Vulture on the way. I can only assume that's going to be mines as well. So four gateways barely just finishing up at this moment. A shield battery coming down. And you can see that Agony has also cut probe production. Needs to save every bit of supply. Now, there is a supply block right now, and I don't see another pylon coming down. These pylons are super late. Agony is in a world of trouble. The first zealot is going to go down. The Vulture is making their way in. They're trying to go for the spider mines. That one Dragoon is going to glitch out a little bit, trying to take out that mine. But at the same time, the shield battery is doing its way in gold right now. Oh my god, Agony just barely going to be able to hold this off. Now, more spider mines going down to delay Agony from being able to counter push across the map with four gateways. This is a terrifying situation. A beautiful hold there by Agony. Throwing down the shield battery. Oh my god, that was a really awesome and clutch maneuver. This does delay Agony from being able to get into really quick tech, but we do see a Robo Bay and Robo Facility out. So we have the shuttle on the way already. This is going to get scary. This is going to require Mafia to know exactly what's going on. Instead, Mafia is going to go for the abuse of the natural being secluded via ground, but very vulnerable to air. So this is going to be a very quick drop play following this all up, but with only Vultures and not that many missile turrets, this is going to be a scary moment. Now, there is an engineering bay, and we already saw one missile turret going down here. A couple more missile turrets need to go down. Reavers can find a lot of ways to get into this base. Now, the observatory coming up behind this. And this is really just because Agony doesn't really need to push out across the map. You only really need the observatory when you want to get out on the map and do things, or that the Vultures are being highly aggressive. But with the observatory being incredibly late like this, I only can assume it's going to be a Reaver into Observer. This might be in time to stop the dropship play from actually doing too much damage. But once the Vultures get back there and there's no Observer, or dare I say the Observer goes across the map to scout out the Terran, if the Vultures get into the back of the base and throw down a lot of mines here, this is all just free pickings. Now the supply depot going down over here. It looks like the first dropship is going to come over here with four Vultures. And already, as I was saying before, all the mines are going to start to go down. But the Reaver, of course, can help out with this defense. Oh, the first Vulture is going to fall. The other Vulture looks like it might get caught by the probes. The Reaver can't really move forward without possibly triggering another spider mine over here. The dropship is going to be able to just kind of quick pick up these Vultures if they get into trouble. There's the Vulture. There's the Reaver shot going to go. And there we go. Another shot going to go down there by the Reaver, but it won't be able to catch any of those Vultures. Vultures, of course, very quick. They do have the speed upgrade. I believe they're able to outrun the shots, but unfortunately not going to happen here. But that does allow for Mafia to know that this is going to be a Reaver play coming in behind this. There's already one missile turret down. More missile turrets coming down behind this. I bet that's a Wraith. It is. And so this might be able to survive, or allow him to survive a little bit longer. Vulture going to drop over here in the corner, and the Dragoons are going to go immediately for the dropship. Very smart play. The dropship will get away. Observers now on the map, scouting out what they can possibly see. The Reaver is actually being held back here. I don't know if that's just for a defensive play or not. The command center now finally going down here in the natural for Mafia. Mafia looks like there's a potential third command center coming out over here. Oh, and the Wraith deciding it doesn't want to go and take out the shuttle that's potentially going to be looming. Instead, going to take out at least one probe. Third base has come up here for Agony over here at the top left-hand corner as well. The shuttle is still just kind of meandering around the base. I guess at this point, it's a defensive shuttle. I think at this point as well, Mafia just is pretty happy with how the state of the game is, given that defended the Vulture drop pretty well. I mean, there was a lot of lost probes, but didn't lose that much more than that. That could have spiraled out very quickly into something like a couple of siege tanks sieging up behind Vulture mines, and that would have been very devastating. One more Vulture is going to come down here. I guess going to put down a couple more of these spider mines and see if we can abuse the main mineral line, and that's going to be pretty effective. The Reaver comes down yet again. Going to get a shot off and be able to take that down. Potentially could have killed one of those probes, I think. I'm not sure actually how that works. I know you can target your own zealots, but I think the explosive damage is not friendly fire. I get a little sip of my cold brew there. And at this point, Agony is sitting in a really good spot. The Natural Command Center has finished up here for Mafia, and really typically, Terrans want to be, shooting down the dropship before it's able to drop more units in there. Typically, Terrans want to be, at best, one base behind, so with the Natural Command Center now finally getting up here for Mafia, Mafia's not in a terrible condition in terms of macro versus a Protoss. But looking at the current state of the game, Mafia getting another position on the map is going to be very difficult. There is another set of minerals over here, but really Terrans want to get into that three gas situation so the 2-1 upgrades can come at a really good time. So far though, the game I thought was going to be over very quickly has gone on a lot longer than I expected. Dragoons moving out over here, going to take out a couple more of these mines, just trying to get a little bit more of this map control here. And behind this, we've got more gateways coming out here for Agony. We are going up to, oh my god, this is going to be 10 gates. Moving on into the mid game, we've got the Citadel of Dune already out as well. We don't see a forge easily. Oh, there are the two forges. Wow, two forges going up to +1/+1 very quickly as well. There's that third command center for Mafia. Now, this is a little bit dicey. Oops, there was? Oh, never mind. I'm sorry. I totally missed something. I missed a drop. I'm so bad. Now, an observer going over to the third command center is going to be very easy. That's going to be a really quick pickup, but curious to see how many kills this Reaver got. Because, oh my god, that... I think actually most of those mines, or all those, most of those SCVs were able to get out of there. It looks like not too much damage was done. It looks like a giant batch of 12 moved back over there. But currently, Agony's in a... I think actually Agony might be going for a bust after this fourth base. Citadel of Dune, not going for a high tech or anything like that. We're not seeing any Arbiter Tribunal coming out just yet. The Templar Archives, okay, now started. So this might actually just be a very slow macro-based play. Shuttle's still moving around the map. It might be able to see this third base. No. Still not able to see this third base just yet. So this third base will stay alive for a little bit longer. There's a single Spider-Mine and a Vulture defending this. Let me take a look to see if there's armory. Double armory going on right now? I'm not seeing an armory here, team. Yeah, with no armory. That's kind of scary. Currently 149, 150 in the food count here. Ooh, another dropship was attempting to get in, but was blocked there. Two siege tanks in there. 150 to 80 in the supply count right now. It's getting a little daunting for Mafia to be able to catch up. Ooh. I'm gonna find one lone siege tank over here, and that's gonna go down. +1 weapons has finished up. That siege tank is gonna die for a pylon. And as everything's kind of spilling out here, it looks like right now Agony is going to be able to take a very dominating lead into the mid game of this map. Early game definitely went over in favor of Mafia at the very beginning, but Agony, with a really quick reversal of that push, was able to pretty much bring this into their favor pretty heavily. Now, there's still Vultures and everything moving around, scouting out to see how many bases that Agony is up to. Here another couple of photon cannons going down. There's a shuttle. Ooh. Where's the shuttle going? Where's that shuttle going? Not gonna get scouted by the Spider-Man. Ooh, but a bunch of vultures are gonna move in counter move to this. And this is a really nice move here by Agony. Moving down and a line across the map to really cut off possible reinforcements and really see if there's any type of reinforcements possible from Mafia. Then moving up to the third base. This third base is completely shut down. This is going to queue up for Mafia to move across the map. Agony now has to deal with this, but there's not that many vultures over here. And this is going to be a really scary thing. In fact, I think just these zealots alone could take out this army. A couple siege tanks are a little bit behind here and need to move up to really support this army. Reaver now coming back in here. The Wraith is still alive, by the way. No, this is a new Wraith. It's like that other Wraith got a kill. But with so many zealots moving in here, a very scary moment here for Mafia. Needs to back up and get out of here. Without any other drops or anything else going on, this is everything for Mafia's army. It's getting completely surrounded by Agony. Agony with a great move in here from all the zealots. The Reaver moving into the middle of this army, just trying to take out pot shots. Mafia is going to throw down a quick quit of that game. I believe there was probably a GG in there, but we're not going to see it. And I think that is going to be game number one going on over here to Urk. All right, ladies and gentlemen. Let's get into game number dos. Great reversal there by Agony. Very well played. Katrina's a weird map, and that's what I was just talking about. That third base seems so incredibly scary. If you lose that map control, handling that situation is going to be really miserable for a Terran. Terrans love those quick, easy thirds. Fighting Spirit. Weird that we talk about Fighting Spirit, right? Only because it's coming to mind right now because I'm loading it up. Fighting Spirit is a great map for Terrans in that regard because you are able to get a very easy third base. So, without further ado, let's get on into game number two. As we move on into Fighting Spirit 1.3. Oh, look at that beautiful, a beautiful map name just moving off the screen there. Well done, Shamtu. You're really good at this. All right, ladies and gentlemen, let's get on into game number two, spawning down here in the bottom left-hand corner from Team Masija. It is our Protoss player in the yellow. It is Smile. And spawning on the other side of the map, it is the teal Terran player from Team Urk, currently up 1-0. It is Stylish. You like that stylish intro there? Already Stylish asking for no cheese. Now Stylish has proven to be an incredibly, incredibly strong Terran. Smile, I believe we've seen a couple of games. Did I cast Masija last week? I feel like I did. I believe Smile only played in the group stages though, in 2v2 or 3v3. I don't believe we saw Smile play any of the 1v1s. I might be incorrect. But the first TVP already was a really great game. I think the second game here is going to be another really good one. As I said, Stylish is a very strong Terran, and I see already people in Twitch chat are already getting excited for Smile as well, so hopefully this is going to be a great game. We've got a barracks going down here at 11, a little bit closer to the ramp, so this might just be a wall off at the ramp. It doesn't look like it's going to be a Rax doubles type style or play. We've got the gateway coming in here from Smile with the assimilator behind this as well, so we're going to be going into a pretty standard map. By the way, ladies and gentlemen, if you are interested, I do have a new Discord chat that I'm using to keep track of all my casting and everything else that I do, ladder play, etc. It's going to have a bunch of friends from a lot of different arenas of my life, so it's going to be very interesting on how that's all going to interact, but if you are interested in joining that, please throw down the exclamation mark Discord in Twitch chat, and I'll probably put the link down at the bottom of my YouTube page. Yeah, so far, nothing really too crazy going on here. Curious to see what Stylish's next moves are going to be because, okay, so we do go down just to one SCV in the refinery. and we'll have that factory go down really quickly. Now, one really quick note that I do want to point out, looking at last map, and this is something that I did want to note, but I wasn't absolutely positive on the timing, but I did want to, I thought I was right. At about 2:30 is about the time that your factory should be going down as a Terran. If we looked at that last map, the cost of Mafia throwing down the refinery to block his opponent's, or their opponent's, gas delayed that factory all the way to about 3 minutes. That was 30 seconds of without having a factory. So that is an interesting thing to note, because not only does that block your opponent, but one thing that I always love to tell people is that when you're getting blocked by your opponent, just remember that they're blocking themselves as much as they're blocking you. It can be useful if you're going for a specific build order, but overall, remember that when you're blocking your opponent, you're blocking yourself. So we've got the Singularity Charge on the way here from the Cyber Core. We've got a pretty standard one gate timing coming out here. It's going to be looking like a 28 Nexus. Another strong timing to remember as a Protoss. Your Nexus should be going down at about 4 minutes, and we're about 3 minutes and 50 seconds. And, oh, never mind. Hold on, where's this probe going? Oh, it's going to throw down the first pylon there. So about 4 minutes, this Nexus should go down, or we're going to probably see some sort of tech if not. Command center on the way. And a pretty standard FD timing coming out here from Stylish. This actually might be a Siege Expand. Yeah, it's going to be a Siege Expand. I'm sorry, I take that back. You can tell just because there's only a single Marine out here. If it's an FD, it'd be a couple of Marines. They'd be having a little, they'd be cracking a couple of cold ones open with the boys, waiting for the tanks to come out. So yeah, it's going to be a nice, very safe Siege Expand. And this is always a really solid play to go for if you don't immediately know what your opponent is up to. So 430, okay, so that was a little bit wrong there. It's going to be a 33 Nexus a little bit later. But regardless, we have a couple of Dragoons moving out across the map. They're just scouting out, taking out those scouting SEVs. Very important for a Protoss to keep the Terran guessing what they're up to. A scared Terran is a good Terran to go against. Command center now moving down here. We have siege mode that's already finished up. And everything is looking pretty hunky-dory. We've got, wow, 7, 8, 9 SEVs moving over for the transfer. And we're sitting pretty happy, I think, between both these two players. We're now going to start to see the beginning parts of tech come out. Robo facility on the way after the Nexus has finished, is going to finish up. And we'll see if we're going to go into either a support bay or an observatory. And what I really like about this is the Smile is playing this very slow and methodical. Going for the academies does delay a little bit of that immediate tech. If you go for an engineering bay, you just spend mostly minerals. If you go for the academy, you do have to spend 100 gas getting the double commsats up. But you get the immediate knowledge of what your opponent does do. And probably just saw the couple of gateways and the robo facility coming up. And at this point, Stylish is feeling totally fine. Stylish is totally feeling very safe and okay. We got plus one weapons coming out from a very quick armory behind this as well, so we're not going to be seeing, I don't think, a immediate command center come out anytime soon. So it's going to be an observatory, no support bay. Or this could be quick third into aggression behind that. That's what I love about StarCraft Brood War. There's just so many build orders you can really go for. And they're all different, and they all need to be treated differently from your opponent. Smile taking this time, knowing that their opponent is being really slow, really methodical. It's gonna go for a third base. This is a really good timing for a third base at this point. You're not really seeing too much aggression coming out from your opponent. You're not seeing vultures go out across the map. You can see the Smile's not really rushing to put a billion pylons down. And you can see the commsat scans coming down here as well. Scouting out for that third base timing. We only have two factories though out here so far for Stylish. We're starting to bank up a couple of siege tanks back here. Now that is an interesting thing. What are you doing? I think this actually might be defense. I think there's a potential that Stylish thinks there's something missing. That is curious. What are these tanks up to? Alright, anyway. So, nothing too crazy coming on. A little observer's coming in here. And this observer is just going to be a sigh of relief for Smile. Smile's going to get in here. Smile's going to see only two factories. Not going to have to deal with any type of... Because by the time that, like... By the time you get into this base with this first observer, if you're going for this timing with the observatory in Robobay, this is about the time that you see five factories. And if you see five factories as a Protoss, you're like, alright, well, I guess I have to cancel all of my plans, and I'm gonna take the next couple of minutes defending five factories. Instead, you get in there, you see two factories, you're like, oh, god, this is a great gift, this is the best gift I've seen from a Terran. So here's one of the more difficult things that can happen for a Terran, is trying to take the third base when the Protoss knows that you're trying to take a third base. So Protosses will do this. So we'll just sneak a bunch of these Dragoons in here, get a giant line coming out here. Ooh, and the shuttle drop on top of the tanks. This is gonna go very poorly here for Stylish. This is gonna be a lot of dead tanks. This is gonna be a very big setback for Stylish. Third base gonna be completely denied. Smile is going to be in a really good position. The Dragoons are trying to take out the command center at the same time. A bunch of Maynard SCVs coming on over here to try and give a little bit of defense here, but there are so many Dragoons down here. Now, finally, there is one more Zealot in that shuttle. That could be scary. And it looks like, a really good counter-offensive coming in here from Stylish. Really pushing back the forces of Smile here. If you get the high ground, you're in a really good position. Oh, there's that Zealot coming back down again. Put the repairing SCVs, will keep it alive. Oh my god, this is a great battle for both these players. A couple more Dragoons coming out behind this, but I think actually Stylish is taking a pretty good victory out of all of this. Oh, I don't know. No, I take it back. Every unit matters here, and losing that one more siege tank is going to be pretty rough, but finally is able to grab the high ground. That was really good work from both of those players. That was great aggression on the third base in there from Smile, and that was a great hold by Stylish. Now, keep in mind, Stylish lost a lot of siege tanks in that, and that's going to delay a lot of pushes that are coming out from that behind this. That's okay. Stylish does have the science facility up at a really good time, 10 minutes. And, nice counter-aggression coming out here, but Stylish did put up the wall. It's going to make it a little bit easier to hold this. Siege tank is going to siege up. And the Dragoons are unable to break that really easily. Anyway, so as I was saying before, the science facility has come up at a good time. We've got the double armory set up. The third base is going to be able to be put up over here. And at this point, I think Stylish just needs to put a nice little wall over here, and Stylish will be totally okay. Now, keep in mind, we're hitting into 11 minutes, and this is when Terrans really want to be at about 100 supply. And at the same time, Protoss want to be way, way above 100 supply. They want to be at like 130, 140 at this moment. So both players have taken a lot of hits. This is a scruffy battle so far. Oh, don't raise that barracks. This looks like it's going to be another bust coming out here from Smile, trying to bust down this army over here. There are a couple of Zealots over here, but I don't know if they're going to be able to get in here. The supply depot has fallen, but the Zealots are getting blocked by the Dragoons. Everything's coming in very piecemeal here for Smile. Smile is losing a lot in this engagement. I don't know if Smile should continue trying to break this. The Zealots are just getting slaughtered before they're even able to get to the Z-Shanks. One more Zealot remains. There's only one more Dragoon. The observers all fall. Smile has failed this bust very miserably. This is a great set now for Stylish. Stylish being able to hold off both of those advances. Not only that, but Smile went for very heavy third base timing. This is a lot of gateways to devote as a Protoss at this early of a timing. And at this point, oh my god, this is so much more in favor of Stylish. Stylish has a +2/+1 on the way. And just able to secure three bases at this point. Now, these spider mines make me so nervous. This is difficult for both sides. Now, the question is, okay, no, never mind, I take that back. Smile was scouted for that fourth base timing. If Stylish was able to scout out and see that this fourth base was already up and running somehow in some miraculous way, I think Stylish would be like, oh god, this is awful. But Stylish getting the scan over here, Smile is now knowing how rough of a position that they're in. So Stylish is feeling pretty happy. At this point, Stylish can play very slow and methodical, build up a massive army. You can see all the factories starting to come down here from Stylish. Smile, on the other hand, has to rush to get back up into a good tech status. Spent a lot building that army and losing so much of it. And look, we're already at 12 minutes, 12, 13 minutes at that. We have no Templar Archives. We have no Stargates coming out here. Smile went for a very greedy bust play, and it did not, in fact, work out. I don't fault Smile for that thinking, though. If you really think about how Smile took so many tanks out over here defending the third base, in all honesty, that bust could have gone a lot better. Unfortunately, a lot of the positioning of the army did not really work out. There was a bunch of Zealots that were lagged up, stuck behind here, behind the massive amount of Dragoons, and the Dragoons were able to poke a good hole, but without the Zealots being able to get right on top of the tanks, the Zealots were able to just be cannon fodder, and the Dragoons became the main targets of those tanks. That really put that whole entire engagement on its head. So, at this point, Stylish is above the Protoss in terms of food supply, and that is just, that is, of all the places and things that you want to be as a Protoss player right now, at least you have map control. Like, that is the number one thing that Smile is still probably smiling about. But without those last couple of engagements going as they did, Smile's in a really rough position. No Arbiters. Ooh, what for... Observer Speed coming out very early. Now that is interesting. Smile could have spent that gas going into quicker Arbiters, but instead decided to go for quicker Observers. I think this is a little bit of a kind of like a stopgap play. I think if I had to guess, I mean, some Protoss players always prefer to go for Observer Speed before Arbiters, but knowing that if you were to invest gas into Arbiters at that point where you're already very vulnerable, the Arbiters wouldn't have come out for a very long time. Arbiters take forever to come out. So going for the Observer Speed was a much easier and quicker payoff, I think. Now this is the daring moment. Terran is getting across the bridge. This is one moment where, as this Protoss player, you decide whether or not you want to engage. Because this is one of the Terran player is most vulnerable, is when they're going to cross this bridge, just because of how the tanks and vultures and everything kind of work up, and you can get a really good concave there. But letting Stylish get across that bridge scot-free is going to be a very difficult moment here for Smile. Smile's got to really back up. Smile's got to get into a really good position. Again, Zealots really far behind the Dragoons, getting completely caught up in those Dragoon numbers. But look at this, God. I wish I played Terran like this. Like, I wish I had control of my army like this. This is just beautiful control and just positioning by Stylish. Here's the sieging tanks getting up already. Now the Zealots are able to get on top of the Terran army, but the Vultures are going to be able to take the brunt force of that. Really good D-Shield going down on the siege tank that's closer to the Dragoons, but all of the Dragoons are absolutely melting. Oh my god, the blue blood! That is all of Smile's army going away so incredibly quickly. Smile is now down to about 100 in the supply. Stylish at 150, pushing down on the Protoss' main base. Smile doesn't have any other gateways anywhere else. This is going to be such a scary moment for Smile. There's no way to be able to easily bank up units and bust this Terran. And at this point, there's gateways trying to desperately go down here at the top left-hand corner for Smile, but that's so far away. The Templar Archives is going to go down next. Now, luckily, oh no, the Arbiter Tribunal, oh, it did go down, it's over there. So could potentially make a couple more of these Arbiters, but at this point, so here's a really scary thing though, and I will always say this, dealing as a Terran and doing the dumb things that Terrans do, trying to bust up a ramp against a Protoss is suicide. It can work. I just barely ever see it work very well in a Terran's favor. At this point, I really like Stylish's decision making, deciding instead to go up to the top left-hand corner, crush out this base. The natural's gone. You can let the Protoss just pour out into the map. I mean, they don't really have a ton of units at this point. But at this point, the better decision right now is to just go over here, kill all the resource mining of the Protoss player. Go from there, and ooh, this is really cute as well. Put in just a couple of siege tanks to be able to stave off any type of easy mining. Meanwhile, we're gonna see Smile go for a counter push. Ooh, I don't like this positioning here from Stylish. I think Stylish should have just banked up a lot of units, knowing that most likely Smile was gonna go for this counter push. I think just banking up a lot of those rallying units yet again is a good call here for Smile. For Stylish, but. Looks like Smile doesn't really care. He's got 3-1 in the upgrades. It's only 1-1 on terms of Smile. And now this engagement is going to go totally in Stylish's favor. Again, 190 to 90, doubling the food supply of Smile. Desperately trying to get this top left-hand corner base, but the third base, gone. The fourth base, gone. There's no mining. Smile is pretty much out of this game. There's the GG, ladies and gentlemen. That is going to be yet another victory here for Urk. Oof. Oof, what a great game by Stylish. GG, well played. Alrighty. Let's get into game number 3. Now, I do want to point out really quickly why I'm covering these matches, why I'm covering the matches that I'm covering next as well. These are the 3rd and 4th place teams in the team league right now. Let me just double check what Faust told me. Urk is currently in 3rd place, Masija is currently in 4th place. So Masija is the underdog in this situation. And so far, Urk is definitely showing why they're the higher seed. But we're gonna get on into destination between these two teams. 1.1. And let's get into game number 3, the last of the 1v1s. Alright, ladies and gentlemen, let's get into game number 3, spawning up here in the top side of destination from Team Urk. It is Caxter, the purple Zerg. And down here in the bottom side of destination, ooh, we're gonna have a PVZ going on today. It is gonna be Hick from Team Masija as the green Protoss. I feel weird saying Hick. I don't know. You know, like, it's kind of like a derogatory term for some people. But I'm just gonna go with, like, it's Hick, like, somebody who's, like, drunk and they're hiccuping. I'm drinking all morning. Guys, tell you guys. This Protoss player, you know, he's got the great mind going on. Speaking of drinking, let me get a little sip of my cold brew. Oh, God in heaven, I make some good cold brew. So it looks like we're gonna have a nice little 9 pool coming out of here. Oh, sorry, overpool. I take that back. I always forget my timings here. 120 for an overpool. I would assume it's probably like 110 for a 9 pool. One o'clock. Or 1 minute, not 1 o'clock. 1 o'clock's a completely different thing. It's a different measurement of time. Hick gonna be able to get over here and know that there's no natural just yet, so Hick, with some very aware playing, is going to be able to block that natural hatchery going down here, which is a really, really difficult situation on destination because your third base position for a Zerg is awful. It's so far open, it's just over here in this awkward position at about 2 o'clock on the map. But instead, Caxter's going to be able to put down 6 Zergling immediately. And interestingly enough, and I should have pointed this out immediately, is that Hick is not going for an immediate Forge Fast Expand, or even a Gateway Expand. It's going to be a double gate coming out here from Hick. A very aggressive opening for both sides here. Now, obviously, the Overpool is a little less aggressive than a double gate. And this is going to be very difficult for Caxter to be able to get the idea of what's going on here. I believe with this Overlord getting over here and seeing the Zealot is going to know what is up. The Natural Hatchery is finally now going down here for Caxer, and Caxer is going to need... Ooh, okay, very smart call. I love this. Putting down the third hatchery in base. Not going to go for the more vulnerable third hatchery because there's just no way that Caxer's going to be able to defend that. So we've got the double gate still on its way, and I think at this point Caxer really just needs to build a large concave of Zergling to really take advantage of these... Getting the Zealot this early would be really... Oh, that would be so good here for Caxer, but... Losing a Zergling for that much damage on one Zealot is really good, but five Zealots coming up here. The Natural Hatchery is still pretty far away, and that means that Natural Hatchery not only needs... Wait a minute, what the hell happened here? What the hell just died? What? Is that the probe? It must have been the probe. The probe got a kill? Oh my god. Ooh, gonna try and catch one of these Zealots out of position. Alright, so now we've got five Zealots moving out across the map. Another two on the reinforcement. His Simulator is on the way with the Cybercore behind this. He's going to be just very strong. One base play coming out here from Hick. These Zealots, Zergling getting into a bad situation. Trying to deny these Zealots from getting here as long as possible. The Creep Colony is on the way. Caxer needs to spend all of their resources building nothing but Zergling and getting the Sunken Colony underway. Now, cool trick that you can do with Zealots is just get the Sunken Colony down to 100 hit points, and it will just pretty much die as soon as it comes up. It'll have 1 HP. But I think at this point, Caxer has done a really good job. These two Zergling need to block the Zealots from getting into the main base. They will not do so. Both Zealots do make their way in here, but... Ooh, another two Zealots gonna walk into the other Sunken Colony. A little bit of micro there. The other Zealot is really hurt. There's one Zealot. It's gonna get into the main drone line. Gonna go for one of those drones. Good drone Joe coming out here from Caxer. Caxer playing this absolutely beautifully. More Zealots coming out here. Gonna scout for the third base. And here comes the counterattack by Caxer. Oh, this is scary. Backing up a couple of Zealots over here in the wings. But at this point, the Overlord sees everything and knows what's going on. There's only one Zealot over here to defend. This is a lot of Zergling, and the Zealots need to make a perfect wall to be able to defend this. There is a Dragoon now finally out. The Zergling are going to be able to get in. They're going to get the surround. The Zealots are going to try and hold this off, but they are going to go down with the surround from the Zergling, and I think this is a very dangerous position for Hick to be in. Now, the Overlord is going to go down. It's going to deny Caxer the ability to make a lot more Zergling in reinforcements, but never mind. So many more pouring out across the map. There are three gateways already set up here. At the same time, we're seeing Messija's Hick go for the counterattack with four Zealots. One more Zealot does come out here. It's going to try and defend against so many Zergling, but more Zergling on the way. There's just too many Zergling for these Zealots to deal with. The Dragoon goes down, and now the Zergling are directly on the probe line. Same time, on the other side of the map, the Zealots are going into the drone line, but they can just fall back to this Sunken Colony over here and potentially get some really good drone drills to deny those Zealots from doing too much damage. The probe drills are going to have to be absolutely perfect to deny the amount of damage from these Zergling. There's not that many left, though. There's only about five, and there's another Zealot that's finally come out. There's still a lot of probes out here from Hick. Hick needs to get a couple more probe drills, but not doing a great job at it right now. The Zerglings are just doing so much damage. Oh my god. The Zealots are also cleaned up before they're able to take out the Sunken Colony, and I think so much damage has been done to Hick at this point. 17 supply left. Oof. What a crazy early game for these two players. Another bunch of Zergling coming in here for Caxer. Another Zealot gonna get surrounded at this beginning stage yet again. There is a Corsair on the way, and this could potentially do a lot of damage. There is no anti-air out here. But this requires for Hick to get into a good stabilized situation. More Zealots are coming over here. There's a couple more Zerglings coming in here. There's one more Zealot moving out across the map, but it's going to be in a really bad position to defend this massive amount of Zergling. The Zergling going right back into the main mineral line, and I don't see enough defenses out here. The Zealots continue to try and defend everything else. I think that might have been actually a scout to get a good probe drill there. Of course, Corsair has come out, I think, or it was canceled. I think it might have been canceled. The probe's trying to go back to the main mineral line, but the Zergling are catching it on the way over. And this is just so many probes going down here. Down to 6, down to 3, down to 2. There's the GG. Pick is going to get knocked out. Urk's Cax are going to take the 3-0 for Team Urk. Oof. I swear. I am like losing my breath. That was a crazy game. Good play from both players. I mean, that ended up kind of looking like Hick was in a really rough position, but if Kick was able to hold that ramp against those Zergling, and Caxter had to deal with a Corsair got out. The Corsair did get out? I didn't even see it. I was looking on the map for it, but I couldn't find anything. Cold brew. A caster's best friend. Yeah, the four Zealots were a little bit interesting. I feel like probably going for the little bit more of the, a little bit more towards the tech side of things, and that could have gotten into a really good advantage. But at the same time, I think if Caxter got to the ramp, knows that there was just a bunch of Zealots, then Caxter would have just teched up easily as well. It's an interesting back and forth of that situation. Well, let's get into the first 2v2 between these two teams. As we go to Othello. Something's going on with the coffee. It's almond milk. Almond milk doesn't really evaporate or mix perfectly well. So it looks kind of chunky, but everybody, I always have to describe this to people. But anyway, let's get into this game, ladies and gentlemen. Spawning over here at the top left-hand corner of Othello, it is going to be our red Zerg player from Team Urk. It is going to be Caxter. And down here in the bottom left-hand corner for Team Urk, it is going to be Stylish. In the top right-hand corner from Team Asesia, it is going to be Darkish, our Zerg player. And in the bottom right-hand corner of Othello is going to be Masesia's Hick, yet again, as a Protoss. Let's move into the team colors so we know which team is which. We've got red on the left, blue on the right. I have gotten rid of the red and blue on my team score, so I don't have to constantly keep swapping so that people are confused. We can just instead look at the team names. Because it was confusing people. I want to come up with an OBS plugin at some point. Maybe I'll do that and sit down tonight that does custom CSS really quickly so I can just do like yellow and blue. Or red and blue, and it does like outlines very quickly. But we have a very early pool coming out here, and we have the wall going up here for Cax. For Stylish. Caxter at the same time going for a very early pool. Neither of these players going for an immediate guess just yet, so we'll have to watch to see what the gas timings are going to be. Okay, so one gas going up. Is it going to be a follow-up gas coming out here from Caxter? Doesn't seem like it so far. So it looks like just instead Darkish is going to go for that immediate. And of course, Protoss doing what Protoss pretty much always does, going for the double gate in the beginning. Now my question here is Caxter goes for the less aggressive opening by going for this spawning pool over here. Are we going to see a very quick, or sorry, no gas spawning pool? We're going to see a quick natural hatchery. The difficulty here for this team of ZT is that without a very aggressive opening from both these players, and what seemingly looks like a very slow play. Oh, gas steal from Hick onto Stylish's gas. That's going to deny any type of quick vulture play. And here comes the first six Zerglings. So anyway, as I was saying before, but Terran walls up. This forces the Zerg to have to play very defensively. So it's going to be the ramp natural, ramp hatchery. And that's just because the Protoss and the Zerg are just like, all right, well, the Terran's just going to wall up and just do a whole bunch of dumb stuff. So we're just all going to team up on that Zerg player. Now, the hatchery over here is going to take a bit of time to actually come up, but that's fine. At this point, Caxter just needs to bank up a lot of Zergling and make them into a really nice concave so that you really dissuade your opponents from wanting to get up this ramp without taking heavy losses. The first two Zealots now heading out across the map. Those Zealots look like they're moving really quickly. And with the gas on the way here for Caxter, curious to see if that's going to just immediately go into speed. I believe it actually already has. Of course, we know over here that... Oh, we're seeing a very quick lair coming out here from Darkish. oh, the nice counter steal of gas out here from Stylish onto onto Hick. Both these players are desperately trying to get their gases underway so they can get into not just mineral-only units. But here comes those first Zealots trying to bust the ramp on Caxter. There is no Sunken Colony on the way yet. And oh my god, I think actually Caxter has lost the ramp very quickly. This is going to be a very quick game. Because already, Mestizia has just busted the ramp. There's really not that much that I can see from Team Urk to be able to stop this from happening. Caxter was just not able to deal with all the Zergling and the Zealots busting up that ramp at once. And this is exactly what I was talking about before. When you have a Terran, you really have to play hyper-defensive. And I think, yeah, this is going to be already a very quick Urk going down. Urk is just going to lose this game. I can't imagine them being able to hold this on. All the drones are gone. And, I mean, you can already see Caxter is down to one supply. The Zealots are going to be able to hold a ramp very easily against Marines. Why? Because Marines are terrible and Zealots are soggy. And there's just no counter-aggression. I mean, at this point, there's only five drones over here. This is a very, very quick game coming out there from Team Urk versus Mestizia. Mestizia will take the first victory of this Game 5. Oh, what's up, Lamb? All right, so that's going to be game number 4 finally going over in Mestizia's favor. I mean, we all know that Zealots are soggy. We all know. Come on, let's not kid ourselves. So remember, this is the third and fourth place setup here. So already, the best of five has already gone over. Technically, to Urk. But Mestizia could even this up and get a couple more points in the team league, because that's really what matters. You need to play through all the games regardless. Ooh, I almost knocked over my coffee. What? That's not spoilers! No, they won the best of five because they already have 3-0. That's best of five. That doesn't mean they've won the entire... Well, I mean, I guess they kind of have. Oh, wait, I think you're trolling me. Never mind. All right, I'm just going to shut up now. All right, ladies and gentlemen, let's get into this game. We've got Urk versus Mestizia on the 3v3 of Hunters 1.1. Spawning up here in the top left-hand corner from Team Mestizia, it is Darkish, the Zerg. In the bottom left-hand corner from Mestizia, it's going to be a bit Star. That's the purple Zerg. And we've got Hick yet again as a yellow Protoss. For Team Urk, we've got at the 12 o'clock position our Terran player, Stylish. We've got Caxter yet again as the Zerg. And in the bottom right-hand corner, we've got Agony, the Protoss. We've got a TZP versus a ZZP. ZZ Top's other band that they made. Let's get into the team colors. We've got red for Urk and blue for Mestizia. And at this point, I'm just gonna stop trying to remember who's who. Now, let's get into the question of who has the better spawn points. Overall, Urk is very spread out. However, on Hunters, the bottom left and 6 o'clock position do share a similar choke point. So, if this is scouted out very early, the rest of Team Urk can block up this choke point and deny the two players from being able to get onto the map. And while they do that, they can take over the top left-hand corner. At the same time, if Mestizia goes for an incredibly aggressive opening, it could be very difficult for any of the team members from Team Urk to be able to rally to defend their allies. So this is a very interesting situation, very dynamic, and the beginning of this game is going to be very important. So we see the double racks coming out here. Ooh, it's not BBS, but it is a double racks coming out here very early for Stylish. We got the gas pool with a very early defensive colony. I think at this point, I mean, they already knew that they were spread out. They didn't know where all the other players were, so they have to just play defensive. Second gateway on the way here for the bottom right hand corner of Team Urk. At the same time, the second gateway has finished for Masija. They're playing a lot more aggressive in this game. The hatchery and spawning pool, nice little Sim City coming out here from this bottom left hand corner player. And the first Zergling are out on the map. A bunker. Ooh, I like this bunker positioning as well. Yeah, I'd say the TPC definitely have the best positioning right now. Just because if they're able to block up this choke, I mean, that's pretty much game. That forces the top left-hand corner to just keep making a billion sunken colonies. And oh my god, the early Zergling aggression is going to be hyper effective here. How many drones are going to go down? We've got one, two, three. No, yes, three drones have gone down so far. These Zergling are just targeting the drones directly. They will be able to get cleaned up, but that was a lot of drones to lose. Back down to six drones on the main mineral line. That's a lot to lose this early in the game. Meanwhile, a bunch of Zergling are going to be able to come out here from Masija. At this middle of the map, we've got Zealot versus Zealot with a probe in the mix. And really good overlord positioning here for Masija. Of course, that's a little bit subject to potential marine counters. The Academy now on the way here for Stylish. And go purple white. Looks like they were trying to coordinate a massive counterattack. I must go red. They're all red. You are red, Stylish. Come on. Remember what team is playing here. Hydra Den coming out very early here. And it looks like there's going to be a little scuffle in the beginning, in the middle of the map. Potentially going on in favor of Masija. Masija getting a really nice counter surround on both sides. Very good coordination from them. But Urk is also getting a couple extra kills between both of them. Ooh, this is a really nice scuffle. But at this point, it looks like we're going to see a really nice collapse on top of the red Protoss player. Backing on up here. Getting into a really awful position. The Zergling are getting a really nice surround on top of the Zergling. It's like the... So they're going to get a really nice surround on top of the Zealots. And a really nice combination force coming in here from Team Masija. And it looks like right now, Hick is in a really interesting... Sorry, not Hick. God. Team Urk's Protoss player is in a really interesting position. A really nice counterattack in the middle of the map. And meanwhile, at the other side, we see a great attack coming in here from Stylish to take out the Sunken Colony. If they're able to do it. Oh, but the medics aren't healing perfectly. And losing a lot of Marines there. God, 3v3 is so hard to cast. A bunch more Zealots coming out here, just staying mostly on Zealot. And I really like this, keeping a couple of Zealots back at home, just for defense, in case these Zealots do get overrun. But with the Hydras out and the Lair as well, you can already see I accidentally clicked on it. Lurker Tech coming out. And the Terran player is going to have the Comsat scan ready for this, but it's going to be really scary. Three Sunken Colonies are potentially going to be over here. At the same time, great attack coming in here from Masija. Coordinated effort, a bunch of Zergling and Zealots going to be able to bust down this Sunken Colony. And I don't know how much longer this Urk player Zerg is going to be able to last. Now they're going directly for the Spire. I don't know if the Spire has already popped out a lot of Mutalisks. A couple Mutalisks could put this game on its head, but the Spire goes down very quickly. That means no more Mutalisks going to be able to come out here. No, it's Zergling coming out here from the Urk player, so not being able to get anything out of that Spire. Meanwhile, oh, never mind, a couple mutas did come out here, but a Spore Colony did go down. Oh my god, there's so many things going on at once. First Lurker has come out, but it looks like it's trapped. Oh no, that Lurker's trapped! Oh, that's awful. So two kills on each of those mutas, so those mutas did get a lot of damage done. Bunker's building up a really big wall over here to lock that... to lock that Lurker and everything else in. Oh, is the Lurker be able to get it? Is there a stim? No, the Lurker does get out. That's not that great. Meanwhile, the coordinated effort of Urk moving down into the middle of the map. In the 6 o'clock position, Protoss is in a really awful position. Abort. I don't know, I think they could break that. With that many Marines and that many Zealots, I can't imagine them failing this. Where'd that Lurker go? There it is. Where is this Lurker going? Oh, there's no detection! There's no detection! Can the drones kill it fast enough? Oh my god, it's getting into the perfect line on top of the mineral line. Meanwhile, the 6 o'clock position, there's a bunch of Marines and Zealots fighting against Besiege. I don't know if Besiege is going to be able to hold this. There are three photon cannons left. One has fallen immediately. There's no more forces left to defend this. The photon cannons are falling so fast, and Besiege is going to lose this Protoss player, but at the same time, there's no way for this to defend. Where's the Overlord? Is there an Overlord on the way? There is an Overlord on the way. There's a Sucker Colony as well. It will be able to outrange that Lurker. Oh my god. I don't know if medics can heal air. That's a really good question. This lone Mutalisk unable to do that much. But this denies so much mining time. Meanwhile, everything over the bottom left-hand corner from Mesija is gone. God, I'm missing so much. There's so much to like watch out for on this map. The Lurker got taken out. It's gone. There's only an Evo and an Assimilator left for this blue Zerg player. Never mind, there is a hatchery all the way up here. And it looks like that is going to be Mesija tapping out. It looks like Urk will be able to take the 4-1 against their opponents. Oh, what a great game. What a great game. Great set. GG, well played. That is going to be Mesija getting knocked down yet again by Urk. I don't know if that's actually again, but... So Urk will keep their title of third place at least for now. And that'll be the end of that series. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for tuning in. I'm going to go on into Red versus Tesagi. Stay tuned. If you're watching this on YouTube, you can find the next on my YouTube page, of course. So let's get on to the next series.